Okay, welcome to the session on challenges in implementing and working with healthcare operations research in healthcare. My name is Mike Carter. And so Dwakar Gupta asked me to organize this, put this session together. And I sent out five emails to five of my friends who have had a lot of experience with trying to implement OR in healthcare. And so they all agreed. They all said, sure. I went, no, expecting two or three to say yes, but never mind. They all agreed, which is wonderful. And so I've asked each one of them if they would take 5 to 10 minutes to talk about some particular aspect of OR in healthcare. And then what I'd like to do, I'm hoping that there are lots of people in the audience who have had issues or have questions, et cetera. So then the second half of the session, we will open it up to the audience and let you guys, I'll pass the microphone around and see what we can generate some discussion. And possibly, right, Amy, we can answer all the questions, right? So we can solve the problems, exactly. Right? And first, I'd like to introduce Marty Puterman. Marty is a professor emeritus at the University of British Columbia, and he's also now working very closely with the BC Cancer Agency, and he's done a lot of work with Vancouver Health and with the Ministry of Health in British Columbia, and he has the scars and burns to show about it. And he's going to talk about working with people who think OR means operating room. Anyway, Marty.
Okay, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here, and thanks, Mike, for inviting me and including me on this panel. So talking about scars, I know you don't want to see the scar I got, but I did get to experience the healthcare system very close up this past summer when I had a hip replacement. And when I walked in, and I was sitting there waiting in the pre-op room, and there's a big sign, OR, over the door, and naturally the title came up. So I'm going to try and be quick. I'll try and keep just a few minutes. So I want to talk about what perspective I'm coming from, namely where I've seen healthcare OR and the particular area I'll look at. I want to talk about organizational challenges. I think that's really my main focus. But I also want to put a bit of the blame for failures or not great successes from the perspective of our industry, what we do, and how we do OR. And finally, some recommendations is strong, hints, suggestions is where I might be going. So my work has been in a public health system in Canada, Vancouver, British Columbia. Most of the work I've done has been working on projects in the systems planning and improvement area. I have done work that might be called public health, might be called medical decision making, but I'm not focusing on that today. It's not where the real challenges I see are. And the one distinguishing factor about looking at the public health system is that we might be using slightly different metrics than in a for-profit healthcare system. We might be looking at more patient-centered metrics. So that's the main difference, and also the hierarchy involved might impact that as well. So the next slide will have that. And my last point, and I could say this since I'm already through the system, is that a lot of the projects we do are not publishable. When you go into to the healthcare OR field, I think your primary objective should be to actually try and improve delivery of healthcare. And I know that's hard giving academic pressures, but I'm sure others will speak about that. I'll come back to that. But I don't want that. I just make that a secondary point. So the structure we're faced with is pretty hierarchical, except I was doing this on the plane coming in yesterday, so I didn't want to put the circles and get them in the right place. But essentially, at the top in our system is the government ministries. They're setting budgets and policy at a pretty high level. In the health systems per se, we have executives and directors, some director level that's doing most of the high level decision making and interfacing with the government. So a lot of the role of the senior executives in our system, at least, and probably in Ontario as well, is working upward, dealing with the government and interfacing with their budgets and doing budget planning, and some of the work's looking downward at the system. Docs fit somewhere in this. They're not below them, certainly, but they might not even be in the same dimension. They're off on the side somewhere, but I just put it there. So they're the they're deciding what healthcare usually should be delivered. Then there's the level in the healthcare system that is actually delivering the healthcare. The managers are managing the units, and the direct healthcare providers, nurses, OTs, PTs, dietitians, care aides, and the like, and then support staff sitting in other parts, schedulers, clerks, food services, all the others supporting that. So in terms of decision-making power, these guys probably have the least. GPs probably don't care so much about what's going on behind the curtain. The way I've thought about this is sort of the front office, back office analogy, that the doctors, physicians write an order for something. And their assumption at that point is it'll happen. The system will deliver it. So they're quite removed from the actual delivery of care until they get calls from their patients that, why am I waiting so long for treatment, tests, diagnostics, follow-up, et cetera, et cetera. The people who really deal with the day-to-day problems tend to be at this level, the managers, decision makers, healthcare providers, support staff. And they probably have the least power. They're not able to influence many other roles in the system very easily. So we have sort of a complicated system where the decision making tends to be fairly top down. Again, doctors are quite orthogonal to this, but these people have some levers to make decisions, but they need support above it. Nothing special here about healthcare. This applies to industry, except the titles might be a little different. If you reverse the picture and look at knowledge of where the challenges are, it goes the reverse way. And the people at the coalface know the problems. So I want to just tell one quick anecdote to keep this fast, is we wrote a paper on a software system we developed for chemotherapy patient scheduling. And probably one of the better papers I've ever written. It was really careful, really well-crafted, describing it. And we got back a referee report. If this was such an important problem, why didn't the executives and directors deal with it more quickly? And that really got us thinking about what was going on in this situation that didn't allow this flow of problem knowledge to be flowing up the stream. So this is what I wanted to say about it, you're working in a very complicated situation where these people know the problems, the people at the top have the power, the budgets and the like, and until the managers interface with the executives and directors or the doctors complain enough, we're not going to see the problems executed. And finally, solution techniques sit in another world altogether. That's namely us, mostly. And as Mike said in the introduction, that usually the groups we're working with do not know what operations research is. And they don't know what analytics is. And that's what my next slide is about. Okay, so the OR teams are usually outsiders in the system. They might be staff members, but they often work in parts of the organization that don't understand what they actually can deliver. They're sometimes in IT. IT is another world in healthcare altogether, and OR doesn't fit there. At our cancer agency, they're been moved into a biostat epidemiology group, which again doesn't, they think about the world completely differently. But more than likely, there's one OR analyst in surgery, one in internal medicine, one in cancer, one here, one there. They tend to be isolated. So it makes it hard to do effective OR. And one thing, one thing I want to note is that we've created an applied center, Center for Operations Excellence at Sauder, and we were able to do very successful healthcare projects. And so what the industry thought at that point was that if they hired our grads, they could do the same projects. But they didn't realize that they needed management who understood the problems and structures that supported these staff members. So the organizations are a bit at fault, but I don't know if it's our professions are at fault, but the organizations are at fault, except when there's leadership that understands analytics. And I know some centers have strength in that area. So, and that's the point here. The OR team, what we can do, and what we can do is not really known. The team, so I mean, I think I've said the last point that OR teams are not well managed by OR professionals, and we don't make good cases for what we're doing. I know we, as a case in point, we tried to overcome this once where myself and Marielle, we gave a presentation to the BC Cancer Society research rounds and talked about what OR is, the different aspects, public health, operations, planning, medical decision making, gave an example of each. And nothing came of it for about a year, but then I got a phone call from somebody saying there's this new special grant coming down the road for funding innovative research in cancer care, and could we form a team? So I think going on, we have to really sell ourselves. The last point is about our projects are hard. They take too long to do. When I work with the team, I have to say we don't have to do the perfect thing, project. We've had projects that I think could have been done in 4 to 5 months that's taken 2.5 years just because people wanted them to be perfect. And that's not always necessary. The big problem with that is that by the time we're done, whoever's sponsoring the project has forgotten about it. It was a problem 3 years ago. It's not a problem now. More likely, they've left. That's the one we run into all the time, that somebody who's been in the leadership is no longer there. Somebody else comes in, even if it's a CEO. They want a different way of doing things. Probably want to reorg, look at higher level issues. Finally, there's lean. There's lean out there with good marketing and high-priced consultants being sold at the top level to the government. Remember who the power had. They're sold to the governments and ministries, and they bring it in top down, at least in the cases I've seen, 3 or 4 cases in Canada, I've seen it. And they've given the opportunity of saying, we can do everything in 1 week with a rapid improvement workshop and involve it and go out and correct a little bit of data. So Lean has gone out there and said, we can do this, why can't OR do it? And that's always a challenge. So I just want to throw those on the table. Okay, and I've said that twice. So OR teams in a healthcare organization probably have a different focus than profs who come in, and that's a whole long topic I could get into, but I won't talk about it anymore. And finally, I'll just put this down real quickly, is that we really have to sell OR. When someone comes in a project, do what they ask, don't do what you want to do. Real easy. Make sure you have sponsorship at a high level, somebody who has some money, who can control the budget and can overcome obstacles. I mean, there's nothing special about healthcare here, really. Engage all stakeholders frequently. Our biggest successes have been where we've had teams of everybody involved, and the biggest skeptic at the beginning is usually our biggest supporter at the end. So make sure you have the teams, and make sure you're meeting them regularly. I have lots of anecdotes, but I'll stop there. And make sure what you're delivering. You don't always have to deliver a state-of-the-art software system. Sometimes somebody wants it. Should we have five or six of these? It shouldn't be a question of, you know, we need software to actually dynamically make these decisions in real time. So we sometimes go over in what we deliver. So I think I'll stop there. I've said, probably gone over my time and probably said enough, but I'll stop.
Okay, thank you very much.
Are you two?
Any quick questions or comments while I do some technical?
Are friends in the back okay with where my mic is? Okay. We've got a question, I think, in the back. Oh, no, that's just saying we're good to go. Okay.
Do you have a question?
No. Okay. Okay, well, maybe people will process this. I think these things go best if there's lots of questions, you know? So I'm going to talk about collaborators.
Let me introduce Brian Denton. So Brian is a professor at the University of Michigan. And we'll plug you in. Plug it in.
OK, great.
Should be good. And he's with the IEOR department, Industrial Engineering and Operations Research. And he's also cross-appointed to the Department of Urology and Medicine, which gives him access to the medical side of the house. He spent several years at the Mayo Clinic as an associate professor at the Mayo Clinic working on practical problems, and I forgot the microphone. I know, I'm sorry. However, anyway, so Brian, please.
I need some help here to bring my slides up on the screen. Okay, well, Mike helps with that. I think these things really, like I said, go best if people have questions. When I look around the room, I see, you know, tons of people that have been very successful at collaborating. There's people in this room that I've collaborated with that I think very highly of. And so I hope that you'll, you know, create some dialogue around this, around what Marty just said or any of the speakers here. So you may need some time to process it, but we should have time at the end to make that work, barring any major technical problems. So I'll tell you what my perspective is while we're waiting for the slides. I come from a different perspective than Marty does. Most of my work is in the medical decision-making area. I collaborate a lot with medical doctors. The research I do, I like to implement it. Not everything gets implemented, but some of the things that I do get implemented. So sometimes that's the goal. Sometimes the goal is to, you know, publish a paper in a medical journal, and I found that can have impact too. Not direct impact, okay, but if you answer an important question, and then you see that question start to get cited in guidelines, for example, that policymakers are developing, then, you know, you start to get a sense that you're having some kind of contribution to actual decision making. So there's a lot of ways to do implementation. So I'll give you a different perspective, and I'm going to talk about collaboration. And one of the things I want to talk about is, you know, why do people collaborate? Okay, so people collaborate because you may need some other perspectives. Okay, so usually when I collaborate, I look for people who have different skill set than I do. Okay, if I want to work on something related to cancer, I feel it's critical to work with an oncologist, somebody who treats, you know, patients. I may want to work with a biostatistician that would bring in other methodological skills that I wouldn't otherwise have. And so these are some of the reasons, you know, that we choose to collaborate. And looking over at my next slide here. I'm sorry?
Yeah,
maybe. poor apologies. I didn't commit the entire presentation to memory. There we go. Okay, can we get it to full screen mode?
View. Yeah, there we go. Okay.
And if you go through view, full screen. All right. All right, here we go. So, I guess this is the age-old question. How many operations researchers does it take to actually project some slides? Okay. So, just a reminder, my talk title, so developing good collaborations and avoiding bad ones. I want to talk about that because a lot of collaborations, in my opinion, probably should never got started or should have failed a lot earlier and could have avoided a lot of frustration. So I told you, why people collaborate, different perspectives, sometimes to get necessary resources. Often we want some data, okay? Well, people don't like to give you data, you know, and then not see you again. So people, you know, are willing to share their resources usually if there's some kind of common goal in mind. And so one of the things I think that is important to make collaboration work is that there has to be some kind of agreed upon goal for the collaboration. And the people that are involved in it have to be incented to participate. So I work a lot with medical doctors, with researchers at the Academic Medical Center at University of Michigan, and you know, they don't have extra time. Okay, their time is accounted for. When it comes to research, they have limited time, and so they need to be very strongly incented to participate. And basically, they have to have something in it for them. Okay, it's just a pragmatic issue of what's in it for the people that you might collaborate with. And this could be all kinds of things. You know, they might just want to improve healthcare delivery, improve patient care. You know, that might be central to what they really want to do. A lot of people want to get some recognition for their work. Okay, more senior colleagues, they may not care. Okay, but other people may view that as important for promotion, for example. If they're on the academic track, okay, then they need publications, and co-authorship is extremely important. So if I look at different kinds of collaborators, some might not care at all about that, and some, that might be a burning need that they have. Some of them are in it for mentoring opportunities. They just like to work with people to help them out, okay, with their careers. I see a lot of that actually at Michigan, so I think that's really nice. And then there's just good old-fashioned money, okay? So I talked to a potential collaborator. They're developing a new system for scheduling surgeries. They called me up. It's a startup. They think they have a great idea. They're trying to get it rolling, and they want some help with that. They are a for-profit business, and they have, you know, something that could help a lot of people. So I think it's critical to know what incents the people that you might work with. And so there's a lot of different kinds of collaborators. This is in no particular order, but academic researchers, okay, they tend to care a lot about publications. They might be MDs, they might be PhDs. If they're MDs, they probably want to publish in clinical journals. If they're PhDs, they may want to publish in a specialized journal. I work with a pathologist who, you know, wants to publish in biomarker journals, pathology journals. Often there's an opportunity to publish some of the work that we do in two different outlets. Okay, so this can actually be a real benefit. When I talk to administrators, they often have a different perspective in mind in terms of what they want to do. They may want to improve, you know, the healthcare system in some way. Other types of collaborators, a long list, but nurses, primary care doctors, specialists, surgeons, you know, they all bring different perspectives. You could work with public health departments, for example. Okay, so this could be a county health department that's looking at population level impact or policymakers, for example. So all these people have different reasons why they might be interested in working, you know, with you. And so what do collaborators need, you know, to be able to be effective, to be part of your team? Okay, well, I think the key thing is they need time. Okay, they need to be incented, but they also need time, okay, to be involved. I think that's the most critical thing. Okay, that's where I see a lot of collaborations fail. Because there's a great idea, everybody loves it. Some of the people that want to be involved, they just can't do it because they're already working 60 hours a week. Okay, and then there are things like resources. You might need funding, you might need IT support. I see that come in all the time, and that's a critical resource. data, you know, various kinds of things to make a collaboration effective. There could be equipment, materials, not for the kind of stuff I do, but I bet for some of you that might be a need. So you need to find people that can contribute knowledge, that are incented, that have the ability, you know, to follow that incentive and actually, you know, contribute time and effort. And that's not always the case, okay? So I was trying to think, how many of the people I talked to about potential collaborations actually turned into great long-term collaborations? And I think it might be something like 100 to 1, okay? Certainly 50 to 1. I kind of have a rule, if somebody contacts me, I talk to them, okay? It's always an interesting hour-long conversation. I learn something, they learn something. Usually we walk away realizing, okay, this is not gonna be an ideal collaboration. But once in a while, you hit the jackpot. So I've got a collaborator that I've worked with for 10 years from Mayo Clinic, and we'll probably continue to work for another 10 or 20 years, I hope. It's a fantastic collaboration. So I think some of the things you have to do to try to avoid, you know, bad collaborations are ask a lot of pragmatic questions up front. Okay, like what do they want to get out of the collaboration? Okay, if you're talking to somebody with a academic appointment at a medical center, okay, and they're on the tenure track, okay, they're very driven to publication, okay? But it can be hard to tell. So at University of Michigan, we have 3 tracks. One's called instructional, one's called research, and one's called clinical. Well, which one do you think is the track that people care most about publishing? How many people think research? Quite a few. Clinical? Maybe one. Instructional? Nobody thinks instructional. That is so interesting. It's instructional at our institution. Okay? They are on a clock. Okay? They are on a tenure track clock. And so they are very, very incented. So you have to do some research to understand what's going on at your institution. Other things can affect it is, do they have a K award? Okay? So if they are funded by NIH, and they have a training grant, or there are other ones, the VA has them, there's many of these, they might have 80% of their time protected for research, okay? If they're on the clinical track, and they're a surgeon, and they're in the OR all the time, then it might be something that they can do on Saturday mornings. And so these are different people with different, you know, degrees of time that they could potentially contribute. The things I would ask are, what do you want to get from the collaboration? How much time can you literally commit to this project? And I try to reach some kind of agreement. I have know somebody who's very successful, who basically develops a contract, okay? This is what you're gonna do, this is what I'm gonna do, this is what we're gonna try to achieve, and let's literally sign this thing, okay? I don't do that, okay? This person's very successful and they wanna be careful with their time and they only wanna work with people that really, really care. So that's an extreme, you may not be comfortable with it, but have this conversation. What's a feasible timeline for the project? Okay, how often are we gonna meet? When are we gonna get things done? And what constitutes the project being done? Okay, and are there other people you need to be successful? Okay, is your team sufficient? Or are there other critical people that need to be involved to make things happen? So these are some of the things I recommend talking about, and I'll just leave you with some parting thoughts. So I said something very negative, 100 to 1, wow, that sounds terrible, but those 100 conversations can be fantastic and you just need to find one really good one. And often it's a lot better than that. But good collaborations are extremely rewarding. They can continue a whole career potentially. So I never turn down an opportunity to learn something about a potential opportunity, okay? I don't expect all collaborations to work out, most don't. So try to fail early. Okay, try to make sure that you detect those ones that probably aren't going to take off. And don't get started on it. And then a thing that's really important I see sometimes can get in the way of things is, never make sure you never miss a chance to recognize other people's contributions. Sometimes you can forget to notice their contributions. You're not watching them 24 hours a day. You know how much time they're spending on things? If nobody cared about recognition, we could probably get a lot more done. We'd have a lot better collaborations, but people do care, so think about those things. And then consider the success of the team as a key outcome, okay? What's gonna be, a measure of success? Maybe a PhD student that gets an amazing job, okay, after doing some great research. Maybe it's your collaborator getting promoted to associate professor, okay? Or an administrator getting promoted to a more important role because of the outcomes of your project. Okay. So those are a few discussion points, and you know, there's lots of people here who know a lot about this topic, so I'd love to hear some questions if anyone has any. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, in the back, Doug. Yeah, let me go. Yeah.
All of us have, you know, not only in healthcare but other areas have done that. I think it's extremely important that someone can learn from, but both of you and Mark said to really you know, kind of drive that home that we need to understand.
Absolutely. I totally agree with you. That's a great point. Yeah. And that for me, I found, you know, fantastic mentors in areas that, you know, I don't know much about, and they've just helped me to understand them. And it's a two-way street. I help them to understand things too. So it's, yeah, can be a great part of a collaborative relationship. Thank you. Other questions? Yeah, I think this gentleman be.
I thought your discussion of collaboration was very interesting. And I guess from my perspective, working in a government agency, I wonder what suggestions you would have when collaborations aren't necessarily, say, your active decision, but rather are kind of forced on you by people, say, more senior than you, people who kind of say you should work with these people and you're kind of pressured to work with them whether or not you think that they're a good fit for the project.
Yeah, that's a great question, and I've had that happen. You know, those are can be kind of tricky decisions you've got to navigate. So saying no can sometimes be hard to do, but I recommend trying to understand, you know, is there an opportunity there? Even if you might think there isn't, maybe there is, check it out, and then try to, you know, come up with a way to articulate what might be the problem with a potential collaboration. Sometimes, to be honest, there's some jobs where it's mandated. You know, when I worked for IBM, I had a manager that used to like to say things like, you will comply. Okay, so some things were hard to say no to, but usually people are pretty understanding, I think, if you approach it with a, you know, healthy perspective and show that you've done your homework. Was there one more question here? Yeah, I love, so these projects can take a very long time. That's the point that was made, and Marty did a great job of emphasizing this. Somebody comes to you with a problem and you show up with a solution 2 years later, don't be surprised that they're not, you know, as interested as they were before. Once in a while, your solution, that problem may bubble back to the top again, and you can get lucky, but setting expectations, I think, is critical here, so people understand what's the timeline, when can they expect to see some impact, and it just might not fit with what they want or expect. Yeah, that's great. So should we?
Okay, thank you very much.
Great.
Pass
thank
that
you.
Off to Sheldon.
Here you go, Sheldon.
Our next speaker, Sheldon Jacobson, is a professor at the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, and Sheldon has done a lot of work in applications of operations research on a wide variety of areas, and one of the areas of interest in particular with pediatric immunization. Mm-hmm. You've done a lot of work on that area, and he's going to talk about the good, the bad, and ugly of trying to publish this stuff in medical journals, which is always a challenge.
There you go. Well, thank you very much, Michael. We've had a phenomenal set of speakers already. I mean, Brian and Marty and Margaret and Amy are going to add their comments. There are a tremendous amount of pearls of wisdom that are going to be shared here. How many of you are at your first Informs meeting, by the way? Anybody in the group? Oh, this is the best session. Just want to let you know. You don't realize it. You've come to the best session. It's all downhill after this. I am very fortunate because in many ways, when you do research in an area, there are often headwinds, especially in the transition period. I have a tremendous tailwind. I have a physician who I'm married to. Now, if you're not married, I recommend it. If you are married, I would say you stick with what you got. But this has really been a tremendous benefit because the culture in academic medicine versus engineering or business is very, very different. And she learns from me, And I learned from her, and we've been able to publish papers together and really understand the culture. We've gone to conferences together. She's come to my conferences. I've gone to her conferences. So it's been a very interesting journey in how this has come about. Now, just a little bit of personal experience so you see where I'm coming from, because everybody does research in healthcare. It's such a broad window of opportunities of where you can apply the kinds of tools of analytics and operations research to healthcare. My focus has been primarily around public health, but I actually started back around 20 years ago in clinical design and patient flow, very traditional stuff using simulation type models. Eventually, started to work in pediatric vaccines, and that actually occurred because I was at an Informs conference in Atlanta, and there was a person there who was at the CDC in Atlanta who was looking for help. And he had spoken to many people, but I followed up, taking Brian's advice, and just follow up with people and talk to them, and it developed into a wonderful relationship. The other benefit that we had at that time is that the problem that they needed solved didn't exist. It was a problem that they anticipated would occur 15 years down the road, and they were trying to solve it before it became a crisis in the public health community with pediatric vaccines. We solved it with many years of room to spare and developed wonderful collaborations with the people with it. In 2004, we started to work on obesity issues. And once again, focusing not around the clinical aspects of it, but more of the societal aspects and trying to, in fact, influence policy. And that's been a big focus of what I've done, just like Margaret's going to talk about so much of her work on influencing policy. There's a tremendous amount of impact we can have in using engineering-based decision-making to influence and to guide policy. We've also done some work on safety in terms of cell phone safety while driving, often bringing an engineering perspective into a public safety issue. And then more recently, I've done some work on residence scheduling, and actually one of my students did a startup and has a little company on the West Coast doing that right now. And then very, very recently, mass murder trends in the United States, are there patterns, bringing our analytic tools and methodologies to the table. So in terms of publishing, my own personal experience, and this is just a subset of what I've done, my particular healthcare research that I've published in OR-type journals include the kinds of journals that you would expect to see us publish anything, whether it was manufacturing, services, production, operations, you know, the Informs journals, which are in blue, Informs Journal on Computing, OR and Service Sciences, and then other ones. I put healthcare management science on this site of the street, because ultimately there has to be some kind of methodological modeling aspect. Because when you look at the journals on the medical side, you start to see things like the American Journal of Public Health, Expert Review of Vaccines, JAMIA, Pediatric Infectious Disease, Preventive Medicine Vaccine, and these are a subset of also the journals I've published on the medical side. But if you look at the papers that I've published in those two, you'll see that they look completely and totally different. Their focuses are not the same. On the OR side, we're looking at the methodology. In some cases, we're even proving theorems, which seems a little strange in healthcare, but nonetheless, there are some fundamental issues. On this side, it's often, if there's a clinical aspect, we're looking at the clinical implication. We're often scrutinizing the assumptions we're making because that has important implications. And if it's public health and policy, what does this mean in people who are going to make decisions? The real people, as Marty's talked about, starting all the way up at the government level. So this gives you a little bit of a perspective of what it comes to. Now, the priorities in healthcare are very, very different than the priorities that we have in our tools and methodologies. Often it is very patient-centric. Safety, outcomes, and access to resources. And these are the things that are very important when it comes to the health community and the medical community. And when you publish, you ultimately want to make a contribution to that. At the same time, in ours, we have these certain capabilities, often focused around decision making, you know, efficiency, optimality, and robustness. And somehow, we have to bring these things together if we're going to make substantive contributions that do have impact. When the schisms start to form between what the priorities are and our capabilities, that's when we start to lose our effectiveness. Now, it really does become a bit of a chicken and egg issue. You know, what came first? How many people think the chicken came first? How many people think the egg came first? See, we don't know. That's the problem. We don't know. Well, the funny thing is we have the same issue when it comes to modeling and medicine. Does the model come first or does the medicine come first? And these are important issues and questions that we have to ask. Unfortunately, from our perspective, because it's our comfort zone, the model often comes first. And because of that, the medicine doesn't always fit. And as a result, the modeling we do is rarely useful. Occasionally it will be. Sometimes we'll get lucky. 1 in 100. Wasn't that the same odds that Trump won the election by? So miracles do happen. But let's look at the similarities and the difference and look at the focus on them. With medical journals, like I said, it's implications on the practice of healthcare. And for public policy, it's policy. Our emphasis is on models and algorithms. To assume you can take a paper that we've written for operations research and send it to the New England Journal of Medicine is not reality. Ultimately, you can have the same research ideas, but you would be writing a completely different manuscript because you're reaching a different audience with different interests, goals, and objectives. So the other thing to look at is the impact factors. And this is something that really gets into the interests of the communities and how they operate and the velocity at which they operate. The medical journals, and I just took three, the New England Journal of Medicine, Lancet, and the Journal of the Medical Association, JAMA. You know, these have impact factors in 37, 44, 59.5. Let's look at some of our better journals in OR. Operations Research, 1.78. Management Science, 2.74. Informed Journal Convening, 1.24. Now, does that mean that our journals are an order of magnitude weaker? And the answer is no, they're different. And to understand that. Now, how does this come about? This is based on citations. There's a much higher velocity of publication and dissemination in the medical community than we have in our community. How many of you have ever submitted a paper to operations research? Okay, most of us have. Anybody submitted to Math of OR? You may have, you're going to get a gray hair waiting for the reviews. It takes so long. And in the medical community, it's a much more rapid turnaround and dissemination because the focus is we need this to reach clinicians and other policy people which can benefit the practice of medicine and bring about a healthier population in some metric. As a result, there's a tremendous velocity which we do not have in our community. Getting used to that in the medical community requires a little bit of adjustment. It's different. It's not bad or it's not good. It is just different. And understanding that, I think, is critical. Now, the other thing is in terms of outreach. If you go to a medical conference, and I encourage you, if you are doing work with healthcare people, go to their conferences, present your papers, but do not present the same paper that you're going to present here or there. You're going to have to change it. But there's a tremendous amount of coverage and interest. Read the science section of the New York Times every Tuesday, and you'll see there's always something about healthcare. Go to conferences, and there are reporters assigned to the conference. This is normal and standard for the major conferences. They want to know what the most recent news is in medical practice and policy. This is standard procedure. OR journals, is there a reporter in the room? Is there a reporter within a mile of here? I'd take someone within the city at this point. As you can, and it's not, there's nothing wrong with what we're doing. It's just that they don't see the relevance and value of our contributions. And it was so appropriately stated that part of it is that we're not packaging it in a manner that enables people to appreciate what we do. I do a tremendous amount of media work, and so do some of the other people on the panel, because I know that. And they don't want to hear about the great models we built to understand obesity and the relationship to transportation. They want to know, what does it mean for the average person? It's like YFM is everybody's favorite radio station. What's in it for me? And in medicine, it's very clear what's in it for me. For what we do, it's not as obvious unless we package it in a manner that people can understand it. And it's our job to do the packaging, the selling, and the presentation and the communication. No one else. If we don't change, it's not going to happen. Kevin MD, and I got this from my wife. I mean, it's a little newsletter you can sign up for. It's free. And you get it, you know, every little while. And from September 2014, there was a wonderful little note which came, you know, healthcare fails to adopt technology. Many new technologies don't address the real problem. Technology is worth nothing if it doesn't solve an important problem or improve lives. Innovators should start with the goals of the end user. The solutions come next. When the orders reverse, the results usually disappoint. This is written by a very insightful physician. It exactly applies to what we do. And if we do not heed this advice, ultimately, we will struggle to have an entrance and have an impact in healthcare through the publication, dissemination, and transition of the research. The message to share in all this is there are significant opportunities for what we do in healthcare. We can do it, and we can publish in healthcare journals. But we have to think a little more clearly what is being looked for, what the focus has to be. It's the medical and healthcare implications. It's not the model. It's not the theorem and the proof and the convergence that we like to do. It's patient-focused decision-making. And for policy, which is what I tend to do more of, you know, it's the implications as well as clinical. Modeling is not the ends, it is the means. And when you publish in the medical journals, it is part of the transition, but it is not the goal. The last thing I'm going to leave you with is a video from the Cleveland Clinic. I'm not going to play it. It's a 5 or 6 minute video. It's been viewed by millions of people. It's called Empathy, the Human Connection to Patient Care. And basically, unless you see what a patient sees through their eyes, you have no idea what they're going through. And that video has influenced my own way in which I look at modeling in healthcare. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sheldon. Quick question for Sheldon, anybody? Okay, yeah.
Is their abstract. I mean, I've learned how to write better abstracts after reading their abstracts, because essentially they summarize the entire paper in such a beautiful way, and they have a very standard format.
Standard format,
because of
exactly.
The velocity that you said. They read these articles quickly. They want to pick up the abstracts, get the information. They need more details. They read the paper.
That's exactly, you made a great point. There's a format, and you just can't put in an abstract in a very obtuse way. You have to tell exactly what your goal is, you know, the method, the description, the implications of all. It's in a clear format, and a certain limited amount of words. Physicians are too busy to be reading the whole paper most of the time. They've got to get the essence. Exactly. Good point, Doug.
Michelle, on the publication side, you know, given the difference in impact and how you see this received, what do you have suggestions for our own community? You know, should we be focused, sort of aligning our focus in how we write or publish?
Well, I think there's still a place for publishing the engineering OR analytics work in our community. But to expect it to reach the healthcare community is naive. It's not going to happen. We have to publish in their community. We have to go to their conferences. We can pat each other on the back and congratulate each other for all the wonderful things we do, but it's not going to go anywhere. It's just not going to go anywhere. We have to visit their world and learn their language, and they're part of the community of what they do. And that means you're writing papers for them. Doesn't mean we stop writing our stuff. We have to start writing more of their papers and publish with them and collaborate with them.
Okay. Thank you very much, okay. Sheldon.
Thank you.
Oh, sorry.
They're often have sort of, I wouldn't say a bias, but a presumption that you're going to have the standard, what's your hypothesis, what's your methods mm-hmm. going forward, versus an engineering approach is much many times of, here's the problem, we're trying to solve that problem,
yes.
and here's how we're coming at. So ahead of time, I don't know what the hypothesis, I don't know what's going to work, because I'm trying to come up with that, and approaching it with building a model or a support system to make things better. And I've had that challenge of trying to package that in a way that fits their standard framework of that hypothesis perspective.
They have a certain culture of how they do things, and sometimes I've submitted papers and they've been rejected because they're outside of that. But I've also found other instances that they've been very amenable to this slightly different view, especially when I communicated very clearly the implications of it. That was the key, the implications. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Next, I'd like to introduce Professor Amy Cohn, University of Michigan. And Amy is, first of all, she's had a great deal of experience working with, in particular, resident scheduling, and a variety of other projects. She's doing a variety of projects with the University of Michigan Hospital, and she's going to talk a little bit about one of my favorite issues is getting data, but you're going to tell us how to do it, right? Amy.
Yes, thank you. So the technology should fit the need, and I was told 5 to 8 minutes, and so I have 5 bullets on one piece of paper. So I apologize for those of you who like visual learning. I don't have slides, but we're going to keep this up because I love this at the last. And for those of you who need to write this down or take pictures, Marty and I were comparing notes when we came in.
Well, I was going to say, too, that this is being filmed, videotaped by Informs, and it will be available for people who are taking notes. This is actually going to be available on the Informs website, I assume.
It's going to be through the editor's cut on healthcare.
Through the editor's cut on healthcare. Thank you.
So Marty and I were comparing both metaphorical but also literal scars before we started the session today. And for those of us who have experienced the healthcare system, this last piece is I think really important, that how we think about these problems from that perspective is key. And so I'm really going to talk very pragmatically. I mean, I've got sort of a nuts and bolts kind of a topic for us today, which is getting data. And when I think about healthcare, part of what to me is so exciting about working in this field is the idea that we're having impact on people at their most vulnerable. And the fact that we are dealing with patients, the fact that we are dealing with this situation means that data is a tremendous source of vulnerability as well. That privacy is enormously important. And so relative to when I've done work with people in industry, for the most part, when we need data, number one, they have it. And number two, they're happy to give it to me. And we might spend a few minutes having a conversation about a non-disclosure agreement. And we're all comfortable with what we're doing. And it goes through the lawyers in the university. But for the most part, I'm going to email you some data. And this is very, very different in healthcare. And it should be very different in healthcare. So this privacy and this protection of the data is critically important. And it therefore makes things hard. It makes things time consuming. And again, it should. Every time we are frustrated by this process, I keep reminding myself, my data, the University of Michigan's in Ann Arbor, it is a small community. My data is out there. My children's data is out there. Your spouse's data is out there. We need to protect that. But we also need to do our work to make their experience better. And doing that requires data. So I have four simple, maybe, points, but hopefully will lead to some discussion when we're done. I think you said it, I think you said it, and I think you also said it, build in time. Part of what we're doing at Michigan's Center for Healthcare Engineering and Patient Safety is trying to improve processes to streamline some of this, but if you are a postdoc with 1 year, if you're a PhD student getting ready to present your prelim exams, if you're a junior faculty member, unfortunately the reality is you will have to request an IRB. That will take time. If you've never done it before, you will do it wrong. If you've done it before, it will come back to you anyway. You will go through churn after churn to get your IRB. At Michigan, one of the things, go ahead. Good question. For those of you who haven't worked in this area before, institutional review is required so that somebody says, why on earth does this engineering faculty member in a field that I've never heard of have the right to our patients' data? Right? So the review board says, okay, the nature of what you're doing and the data that you want in order to do it seems reasonable. That is not a trivial process. At Michigan, for the most part, what then happens in many cases is you take that IRB and you go marching into what used to be the Honest Broker's office, but basically IT people, and you say, here's my ticket. I'm allowed this data. I would like the data, please. And they will put you in a queue. And they will eventually get to that. And then they will evaluate, do they think that the data you requested is valid for the IRB that has approved you? And then they will give you the data. And you will look at the data and you will realize, that's not quite what I meant in retrospect. I need something slightly different. And you will go back and you will amend your IRB. And then you will request data again. I said I was going to be optimistic. One of the things, so optimism number one, that means my data is really, really, really being kept safe, and that matters. Number two, as we as a community get larger, as people, certainly at Michigan, part of what we're trying to do is my experience of going through this is being documented and tracked and managed. And we're engineers, we build processes so that the next person going through this, who might be more time sensitive, can benefit from what we've done. We're also doing an enormous amount to try and educate our institution about, it's in your best interest to give me this data, right? Because we are going to help the patients that you care about. So number one, build in lots and lots of time. Number two, find the IT people, find the IRB people, find the data warehouse people, figure out if they like chocolate, if they like nice wine, if they like gardening, make friends with them. Because this stuff is really complicated, and we as a community are not yet to the point where we're doing a really good job of sharing our learnings and helping each other. And so when you go through this IRB process, if there's someone who says, oh, let me help you, I know how to do this, we can get it done quickly, we can follow a template, we can use my shortcuts, that matters a lot. Having an IT person who will say to you, are you sure you want this and not that, is surprisingly valuable. And I'll give you one concrete example. Michigan, the University of Michigan, like many institutions, has gone through a fairly major Epic implementation. Epic is the electronic health record. Many, 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 many hours and dollars have been spent on this. You don't go into a very large institution and turn a switch, which means that different parts of the health system went live at different times. I might want data that looks at the emergency department and inpatient because I'm trying to understand how discharges from inpatient back up into patients boarding in the emergency department. And so I say, I want timestamp data, da, 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 da. Here's the worst case scenario. I say, I would like data for the past 5 years on this information, and it takes them months and months and months and many, many dollars to get me that data. Here's the best case scenario, which is similar to what happened with us. Someone says, you know, the time period that you're requesting spans neither was on Epic, and then just inpatient was on Epic, and then the emergency department came on board with Epic. In order for us to get you the data that you are asking for, we have to match across multiple different systems to get all of the data to give you what you asked for. Do you really need 5 years? If instead of waiting to get all of that infrastructure in place to give you 5 years of data, I could give you 1 year worth of data or 2 years or however long since everybody was on a common system, how would that go? And I say, I just said 5 years because it seemed like, you know, there was no statistical significance. I said, I'd like a lot of data. If you're telling me that by giving me 2 years of data, you can give it to me 6 months faster, yeah, I'm good with that. But you need somebody who's going to say, did you know that this is a problem? This is how we gather data. So it's not just about, you know, to your point about understanding the clinical problem. It's not just understanding what it means to have diabetes or what it means to go through surgery. Understanding what the data people are doing, understanding how these systems talk to each other can really help you. And if you have a friend who says, oh, we really don't want to get it from this system, let's get it from over here instead, that can expedite things enormously. Number three, be proactive in your data management. Again, did I mention that this is my medical data that you're looking at, right? We need to demonstrate to our clinical partners, especially when they're new collaborations, and we need to demonstrate to the people who are going to give us that data that, yes, we didn't go through medical school, but that doesn't mean that we don't recognize in the same way the value and the security of that information. And so when I sit down with the data folks, the first thing I say is, here is how we store the data. Here's the HIPAA is the privacy laws. Here's the HIPAA compliance server that we've set up. Here's our policy so that every semester when new students come on and students go off, here's how we document and here's how we passport protect that data. Here's the training that we and our students go through in order to handle that data. Here's where we're going to store it. Here's how we're going to transfer it. Here's how we're going to touch it. And being able to say that, and I think maybe for those of us who are doing this to be sharing our best practices, when you go in and say to someone before they ask, by the way, this is how I'm going to do it, that confidence goes way up. And again, it helps you make friends. And the last thing I want to talk about is trusting your data. Okay, you have to be really, really careful about how you interpret what your data tells you. For me, a lot of my work is a combination of scheduling and patient flow issues, so timestamps really matter to me. we've spent maybe a year now on a project that ultimately will lead to improving flow through infusion, but traces all the way back to phlebotomy, so where you get your blood drawn. And one of the questions we were wondering is, how long do people wait to get their blood drawn? Well, there is a time stamp for when somebody starts entering your information into the system to pull up your orders. There's a time stamp for when they start to actually draw your blood. We don't know how long you waited in the waiting room before they actually started processing you. So we have a start time that you could easily interpret as I walked into the waiting room, but in fact is actually 30 minutes after I walked in the waiting room when they finally got to the top of the queue with me. We have information about when we began your blood draw, but we don't know if you sat waiting for an hour or if they were working through with your clinician what the orders were. So understanding and talking to people about what does this field mean? What exactly does this data mean? And understand who's entering that data. Is a nurse taking 5 patients' vital signs and writing it down on a scrap of paper and then going to her computer or his computer and typing those in, right? Because if you're tracking things and as engineers, you know, CPLEX, the default is like 0.00000000001%. You can get data to seconds in your timestamp. But if someone is doing it in batch, does that data mean what you think it means? And so I'd encourage that as you're getting your data, we finally made it, we've got our data, a lot of it's wrong and you need to clean it. And you need to be very clear in your writing about what your data means, where they came from. But I'm ending with optimism, which is that we are getting data, we are being trusted with that data, we're handling that data well, and we are using that data to solve problems, and that's the whole point. So, optimism. Optimism, Mike. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, any quick questions? Okay. I'd like to, now, last but not least, understatement. Margaret Brandeau, professor at Stanford University, woman who needs no introduction. So, Margaret, I'll do it anyway. I could spend the rest of the session introducing Margaret. And she's-
I paid him.
Yeah, right.
My agent.
And later. So Margaret has worked with the WHO, she's worked with CDC, she's worked with in Africa, in Russia, all over the world, actually implementing and developing public policy that people are really using. Thank you very much, Margaret.
Thank you. My slides. So I'm going to talk about moving the needle in public health. I think a lot of what I'm going to say has been said very eloquently by my colleagues here, but this is going to be a focus on public health. PowerPoint. Mm-hmm. There we are. Then you have to share the screen. Perfect. So yes. And does this work? Yes, so I'm going to talk about moving the needle in public health, hopefully in the right direction. So I think the first thing, if you want to influence actually any problem, but public health is an example, but if you want to have any kind of influence in health, it's to pick the right problem. So I think it's really important to identify the problem that people care about. You can make the most beautiful model of a not very interesting problem, and I'm afraid I'm doing one right now, but long story about that. You could make the most beautiful model of a problem that isn't that interesting or important, and no one's going to care. But if you pick a problem that people really care about for some reason, even if you just, and as was mentioned, you do a quick analysis, you do a good analysis, that will have influence. So it's to pick the right problem. As was also mentioned, and I've experienced this again and again, it's to form collaborations with domain experts. I think in, especially in operations research, we tend to have a bit of a paradigm of you wrote your theorems, maybe with your advisor or your PhD student. And when you're working in health, that's just not really a paradigm that works. I've just seen again and again, it's really important to work with those who know. Those people who know what the field is. I also think it's important to form collaborations with influential individuals. So I did some work on hepatitis B control in China and the United States with David Hutton, who's sitting right here. And we collaborated with a transplant surgeon from Stanford who basically has decided to make it his life's work to improve the lot of people in our world who have hepatitis B infection, that is, get more vaccination, more screening, et cetera. And so this guy, Sam So is his name, he had already spent a lot of time working with people at the WHO, working with the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention in the United States and China. So he's very influential. So we collaborated with him, and so right there, you're gonna start having success. And I've in other projects, same thing. For example, I collaborate with people at United Nations AIDS Program because these are people who have influence. As I mentioned, and as was mentioned earlier by Sheldon, I believe, if you do your analysis quickly, then it's going to have impact. If it takes years and years, it may not. So I think quick is good and also simple. Public health decision makers very often really just want to hear a simple, clear message. And if your model is just so complex that nobody knows what you were doing, never going to have influence. But of course, it has to be realistic too. And this was also talked about in the publications discussion by Sheldon, but it's so important to identify just the key findings and to be able to just say in one or two sentences, this is the main thing I found out. Even if it's just my scheduling algorithm provides a better hospital operating room schedule than was done previously, but very important to do that. So do a good analysis. The second thing, though, so let's say you've done that, you found a great problem, you got some collaborators, you did all these good things, is to disseminate results. So in public health, there is no single decision maker. If you go do work for Hewlett-Packard, for example, hopefully the vice president or the CEO or someone will say, yes, that's great, we're going to implement it. Public health, there's no decider. And so what do? Well, the first thing is to publish in visible medical journals. I think people in public health do not necessarily respect what you've done unless it's in a well-regarded medical journal in whatever that field is. And to do this, as also was highlighted, you know, clearly state what you found out, but also what are the limitations of the work. I also think another way to have influence is attend domain conferences. So for example, I go to the Society for Medical Decision-Making Conference, and a number of people in this room go to that conference, I know. I started going there about 15 years ago, and at the time, there were no operations researchers who went, as far as I know. And now I just was there like 2 weeks ago at the meeting in Vancouver, and there was like a whole session on model calibration. It was like pure management science and analytics and operations research. So I think we're slowly spreading our tentacles. And I think it's really important if you want to have influence in health in general or public health is to go to conferences that people where people in that field go. Also, meet with influential individuals. Again, no single decision maker, but to the extent you can meet with as many people as possible, that's very useful. And get to know people. So I work in public health, and I have done a fair amount of work on HIV policy. So I realized when I had a sabbatical a few years ago, what a great idea I should go to do my sabbatical at the United Nations AIDS Program in Geneva, Switzerland. And who doesn't want a year in Geneva? But it was actually really good because now I know a lot of people at the United Nations AIDS Program and World Health Organization. So, you know, if I say, well, we've done this and we found out that, then they kind of know who I am. So just in general, trying to get to know people, even though there's no one single person, it's a process. Then serve on committees. So for example, editorial boards and review panels. So I don't know if anyone here has, I know some people here have actually, but where NIH might say, could you please serve on a review panel? Because we need someone who knows models. So I think we should be saying yes. Because I've been to a number of those review panel discussions where they're reviewing someone's proposal and the people reviewing it have no knowledge of what is a network model or what is, this optimization algorithm someone's proposing. So I think it's important for us to get out there and have some influence on review panels and also editorial boards. There are medical type journals where we can serve. So the journal Medical Decision Making is a good example, where we can and should be on the editorial boards. To the extent possible, serve on policy committees. So after we had done the work on hepatitis B, I was asked to serve on an Institute of Medicine committee about controlling viral hepatitis in the United States. So I said yes, because we have to get out there as modelers and represent what we can do. So to the extent possible, if you have the opportunities to be involved, I would say yes. Then I also think, so suppose you're serving on committees in whatever way, editorial board or review panel, whatever, I think it's really important to be able to, and this was also highlighted by previous speakers, to explain what your thinking is. Like, I came to this conclusion because of this reasoning. So you got to really be able to explain clearly, like, I think that's a good idea or a bad idea or whatever. So I think with my three-step path to success, which is perform a useful analysis, disseminate results, and serve on committees, I hope that we will all achieve success. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Margaret. What I'd like to do now is invite all of our panelists to come up and open it up to comments, questions. Your turn. You have the audience now has
a question for the panel, I guess, but it was triggered by something Amy said in almost opposition to what either Brian or Marty said earlier. How can you reconcile your need for lots of time to be able to obtain process data with their need for analysis not to take too long because people will forget that it's an important problem?
So my response to that is going to be a bit different than you might expect, in that the teams that I'm working with are based in the healthcare agencies themselves. And the big success that for our team, this is the BC Cancer Agency, is that people in the team know more about the data than anybody in the whole organization. So they become real experts on data. The downside is that they get a lot of requests directly for extracting data. But it's not like an academic university or academic institution holding the data outside of the place where the analysis is done. When students work in the environment of the agency, they in fact do sign disclosures, so they can't comment. And all the data we work with even there is anonymized anyway.
I'd like to make a comment too. I think what Amy said is really valid, but there's a lot of different contexts that you could work in. So if you're working on problems in medicine, for example, I find it a lot easier to get data, sometimes within 24 hours, if you're working with people who have developed good research data sets. It can vary a lot. Sometimes it can be very fast, sometimes it can take a long time. Depends on what you're working on. Any other?
Other questions, comments, suggestions? Yeah. You want to, I'll come to you.
Hi. So often the problem that I'm kind of looking into is.
I don't think we can hear you up here.
Okay. All right. Probably should just stand. Whenever I'm looking, so I work in application and look at intervention analysis in respect to policy, and I work with CDC and WHO. And the trouble that I often face is that when I'm writing publications for policy journals, their turnaround time is much faster than the modeling journals. So, but whenever we publish in policy journals, they need an appendix for the model that we used. But at the same time, you know, we want to publish that model in a modeling journal. So I was wondering if, you know, if any of you face this, the time lag between policy journals and modeling journals, and how you've handled that.
Yeah, does anybody over here want to field that? I could say a few words, but, what? I don't have a great answer. That's a tough problem. Okay, I see that problem all the time. I send something to a medical journal, and it could be published in a few months. I really want to cite back to a methodological journal article, but that can take maybe 3 years. You know, so it's a real challenge. Sometimes we delay on a submission. Sometimes we just don't articulate the methodology in a very detailed way. And in some cases, like clinical journals, may be okay with that. We'll provide a short appendix that describes some of the methods. Sometimes we'll, you know, cite back to a working paper. But it is, you know, it is a real challenge and something you have to think about and try to navigate. And I don't think there's an easy solution. But maybe somebody here has one.
Oh.
Yeah, Margaret. Margaret's got the solution.
Well, I don't know about that.
Okay.
I think your point is well taken. We think about that all the time. I think one of the things you can do is you have a short, brief appendix, but then you send your working paper so the referees can see it. You say, you know, this paper has been submitted, you know, under review, and here's the technical details of the model, and they're fine with that. So you can, you know, you just send it specifically for the referees, but you continue to pursue a separate publication path for it.
In our community, literally the referees get in bed with you. I mean, they are literally just... Well, my co-author, my wife, literally does get in bed with me. But we are actually very harsh on each other within our community, and that's that is why, in some sense, our velocity of publication is so much slower. In the medical community, it's a tremendous turnaround. We also, in the medical community, get many more reviewers. I have found that I'll have 5 or 6 reviews for some journals, but they're touching on the most salient points in terms of policy or practice, which in our community, it's just a completely different focus. And there is this difference, but that's why they have a impact factor of their top journals of 50, and we have, you know, 1.5. That difference is reflected in the velocity of which we communicate and disseminate. The solutions are not easy. I think Margaret's point is what you do. You know, here it is. They're not going to look it in detail, but they want to know in the medical side that there's something there. And ultimately, it will get published. It just takes a lot longer.
I think the MSOR journals are getting a lot faster, they are, you know, pushing to shorten the time, but absolutely the difference is still an order of magnitude. Yes?
I have a question related to the same topic. It was actually spurred by something that Sheldon had said with respect to having the model come first versus having the outcome, if you will, come first for like the chicken and the egg problem you had mentioned, right? So you had suggested that the model doesn't or shouldn't come first, per se. So with respect to publishing, would it make sense to publish in the clinical journals first over publishing in the OR journals? Or do you have an opinion on that?
Well, just on the speed of dissemination, I can assure you if you submitted the articles at the same time, the medical article will get published long before the analytics article. That's the way it is. I wouldn't call that a recommendation. It's just a natural process. The key is, who do you want to reach with your publication? Our job as researchers is to communicate, disseminate, and influence and impact. We want to add value in a societal way. We want to make the world better. And our publications are the venue that academics use to achieve that. In the medical side, they want to look at patients, policies, influencing health, improving. On our side, on the analytics side, that isn't part of the equation. It'd be nice if it is, but it's not primary. Does anybody else want to add?
So this is obviously an issue often for the junior faculty. They want to publish rapidly, and when we are reviewing their cases, coming up for promotion, we are emphasizing publications in our own journals, and the journals are very slow. What would be your advice? I mean, we both sit on the editorial side of our journals, and some of others in the audience. Should we give much shorter time to the referees to say, well, come back with the report, else we move on? And I can tell you that on the medical side, I've had rejections of papers that were not fit to the journal in less than 2 days. And I think that's appropriate if we are willing to accept that, so that we can move the wheel a little bit faster than sitting on something for six months. And sometimes you overrule referees, associate editors, or area editors make decisions. And if area editor is tardy, then the department editor and or the special issue editor makes those decisions so that we move forward. Because sometimes our journals, the papers just sit, nothing happens.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a great point. Actually, the Informs Board had a four-hour discussion about our journals, and this is something that came up. It's a very important question. Some journals, like MSOM, Management Science, have shown that you can have very fast turnaround, and others aren't as fast. And it's not easy to have fast turnaround when you're sending 35-page manuscripts filled with theorems and proofs. You know, it's tough, but you know, my opinion and the opinion of a lot of the board members is that we need to do a better job at that. You know, we need to have more visibility to how long things are taking, and figure out some ways to speed up, you know, the review process to the extent possible.
But I'm also saying that we should give discretion to the decision makers, the journal editorial boards, to say, well, referee is behind. I've been behind many times, I promise.
And your hands get tied with so many other important things that you just don't get to referee those papers. I think the decision maker in this case, whosoever higher up is, should say, well, we can just move on with one report, and sometimes even with no reports.
Yeah, yeah. It's really a matter of culture. We have 14 journals with 14 editors-in-chiefs and many, many editors. So it's largely a matter of culture, I think.
Yeah, I want to answer your question a little differently, maybe not what you expect. I think Sheldon came very close to saying it, in saying that when you publish in medical journals, if the journal thinks the paper is at all good or something that the public might value, they'll work with you to create a better paper. Our field has evolved throughout my career that the referee reviews now become very, very complex. It's very rarely you'll submit a paper that doesn't immediately say, well, why don't you do this, this, and this? And it's usually very hard, this, this, and this, and ending up with different papers. So the question is, why don't you prove this result? And in one case, the answer is, this is an open question in the field, you know. So I think that it's not only the turnaround, it's really the way that referees view the work and look at it as somebody who could be on an editorial board supporting publication rather than somebody who's inhibiting publication.
I'll add one last comment. Now, Sandra, you've opened up a can of worms, because it really is a P&T, a promotion and tenure issue now, and this is part of the way universities evaluate this generation of healthcare OR people. And that we're in a transition, because the people who are using traditional metrics for non-traditional evaluation are not getting it. And I have written P&T letters, promotion tenure letters, for people in this room, and made that case of why it was important for them to get promoted, even though by the traditional metrics, there were the old guard who did not necessarily value it.
There you go. Sorry. So this relates to the P&T issue a little bit, but also collaboration. So I was hoping to get the panelists' thoughts on the kind of the mechanism for splitting your research and publishing one in an OR journal and publishing one in the impact. I'm doing this now, but it's something I always kind of struggle with, as far as, you know, how do you make the decision on which projects you can split successfully? Because in the end, you kind of reserve, you know, the impact side for the medical journals and the modeling side for the OR journals, and in some cases that could actually maybe weaken it a little bit, because you're not telling the full story. So I was wanting to kind of get your thoughts on how to make that decision.
I mean, I'd like to say do you have two stories to tell? Yeah. If you have two stories, then yes, by all means, you should publish in both. But if you're, in many cases, we use fairly straightforward, simple OR to apply to a very important policy question or operational question. And so we don't publish that in an OR journal because there's no real contribution to OR, my opinion. So go ahead.
So, and this kind of comes back to George's question earlier about what do you do when you're working with people and the work you want to do is going to take 2 years and they want something right away. I think this is a tremendous opportunity for us to be giving much younger students experiences. So at the master's and even the undergrad level, that in many of our collaborations, we have teams where there's some of the work that's really not, it's not PhD level work. It's not OR publishable work. It is still very important in the clinical setting. It hasn't been done before. And so there's this sort of quid pro quo, and comes back to your point about what do we want about out of this collaboration, that we will provide you with access to the clinical environment and data and the time for a PhD student to deeply study a problem, knowing full well that they may not provide something that we can implement anytime in the foreseeable future, although it's important to the larger vision. But in the process, we're also doing analysis and some, you know, in some cases, creating spreadsheet tools that have immediate impact and value to the clinical partners. And so they say, okay, we see where providing what you need for this academic work to go forward is beneficial because of this sort of sharing of resources.
But I also think that instead of taking something you did to solve a problem and saying, I want to break this into two papers now, we tend to focus more on, here, we solved a real problem. And then are there some theoretical implications? And we write a totally different paper. So for example, David Hutton did some work on catch-up vaccination for hepatitis in China. So very, very practical. But then we realize, oh, well, there's a broader theoretical question of when should you stop catch-up vaccination as more children in the population are getting vaccinated. And so then he did some theoretical work on that and published it in a different journal. So I think it's not so much breaking your paper into two as it is solve the real problem however you do it. And then if there's some higher level theoretical insights, then you could write a more theoretical paper.
I'd like one. Brian gets the second last word.
Can I steal your microphone? This feels really cool.
Another thing I would mention is, you know, maybe this is more for junior people in the audience that are thinking about where to go. You should think carefully where you want to be. Do you want to be in a school of public health or engineering or business school? If you go somewhere that, you know, getting promoted with tenure requires you to publish only in operations research and management science, you know, you should do that, understanding that that's what you're getting into. If you want to publish in medical journals, you probably want to be somewhere where there are some people that are going to respect that. So these are the kind of questions you might want to ask when you're interviewing, you know, so that you end up somewhere where the incentives, you know, are aligned with what it is you really want to do for your career. So.
Okay. One last word here. Sanjay is asked to make a brief announcement.
Actually, a piece of advertisement here. We have a session in SC in the same room immediately after lunch. That actually, you can think of it as a case study for a lot of the ideas that were shared early on. We have four top tier decision makers in the area of transplant coming for that session, actually especially flying in today for that session and flying out. Some have actually taken a break from their vacation. So just to give you a sense of the level of engagement and interest from the clinicians for that session, we have the current president of American Society of Transplant Surgeons. He's coming. We have the vice president and the incoming president of the United Network of Organ Sharing and OPTN. She's coming. We might actually have the current president of UNOS also drive in. Because of his interest. We have the person who actually makes decisions on the side of the government. The HRSA that overlooks, the arm of HRSA that overlooks transplant, Melissa Greenwald, she's coming for that session. And then we have our own experts in that session who have made operations research contributions in that area. A session is organized around policies. There's a ongoing debate in that space, so in that sense, it's very, very timely. But the broader goals we'd like to be achieving in that session
is to really use it as a case study so that the lessons we are learning from actually applying some of our OR tools as they are being disseminated in that area can actually be more broadly spread and possibly engage now within the transplant space experts from the clinical side as well as those from our community. So I'd like to welcome you all to see if you can be part of that session and come up with all kinds of great follow-up questions to this session. Thank you. Mike, thank you very much.
Thanks, Sanjay. Okay, I'd like to thank the panel and thank you very much, Deb, and thank you all.